those folders down the road. We encourage you to recognize any guests here and welcome one another. We have several announcements today that are in our bulletin, and I would like to bring a few of those to your attention. Next Sunday, June 25th, we will be having a mission team meeting following service at noon. We have a picture in our slideshow. This is Christina here and her two children. Our mission committee is looking to put together a mission team to help build a home for Christina and her children. Christina lost her home in the tornado that hit Appomattox last year. We remember that there was a tornado in Appomattox and everybody that destroyed several homes. Well, Christina, her father, and her sister all lost their home in that tornado. And Christina's father has received a new home with assistance from FEMA and different disaster relief organizations. But both Christina and her sister were unable to have a new home built for them because they were renting. And if you are renting your home, you do not qualify for disaster relief funds. So they have been living with her father for over a year. And Christina and her two beautiful and active boys bought a home of their own. So Bethlehem United Methodist in Manita has partnered with United Methodist Volunteers and Mission to build Christina's home. And they have fully funded this home from the ground up, and now they are looking for volunteers. They're looking for churches and organizations to help them. So next Sunday, June 25th, immediately after service at noon, we will have a meeting in our conference room. Part of our mission team. We will look at dates and talk about ideas, and we hope this will be an intergenerational mission that the entire church can be a part of. We're looking for anyone that likes to build and swing a hammer, to anyone willing to make sandwiches and encourage our workers to drink water. So we welcome all ages to be part of this project. Another announcement, Tuesday, June 27th, we have our church picnic. We will again be at Fieldville Park this year. The fried chicken will be provided, and we encourage our members to bring side dishes for our covered dish picnic. This will be an exciting picnic as we will have music, special music following the food. Gone Fishing, the Bluegrass Gospel Band, will be performing. And I am a little biased because my husband and my father-in-law play with them, but I think you will love the group and what they have to offer as we sing and worship. That will again be Tuesday, June 27th at 5:30 p.m. And then, June 26th through 30th is going to be a great week here at First Land Memphis as we have Vacation Bible School in our Uptown Ministry Center. It will be from 8:30 to 11:30 a.m. And our theme is Hebrew Central, Discover Your Strength in God. So we hope that you will come out those mornings and check out Vacation Bible School and all the hard work that Annette and all of our volunteers have put in there. It will be a great week full of fun and learning about God. And now I encourage you to join me in our call to worship down in front of your bulletin. Please stand.
Let us pray.
Dear Lord, we thank you for bringing us together. We want our pastors to be able to have a break and to have a Sabbath and to worship one another. We will now be hearing from the Word. And our Old Testament lesson today comes from the book of Psalms, chapter 27. Hear the Word of God. The Lord is my light and my salvation, so why should I be afraid? The Lord protects me from danger, so why should I tremble? When evil people come to destroy me, when my enemies and foes attack me, they will stumble and fall. Though a mighty army surrounds me, my heart will know no fear. Even if they attack me, I will remain confident. The one thing I ask of the Lord, the thing I seek the most, is to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, delighting in the Lord's perfections and meditating in his temple. For he will conceal me there when troubles come. He will hide me in his sanctuary. He will place me out of reach on a high rock. Then I will hold my head high above my enemies who surround me. At his tabernacle I will offer sacrifices with shouts of joy, singing and praising the Lord with music. Listen to my pleading, O Lord. Be merciful and answer me. My heart has heard you say, come and talk with me. And my heart responds, Lord, I am coming. Do not hide yourself from me. Do not reject your servant in anger. You have always been my helper. Don't leave me now. Don't abandon me, O God of my salvation. Even if my father and mother abandon me, the Lord will hold me close. Teach me how to live, O Lord. Lead me along the path of honesty, for my enemies are waiting for me to fall. Do not let me fall into their hands, for they accuse me of things I've never done and breathe out violence against me. Yet I am confident that I will see the Lord's goodness, where I am here in the land of the living. Wait patiently for the Lord. Be brave and courageous. Yes, wait patiently for the Lord. And our New Testament lesson for today comes from Ephesians, chapter 4, verses 15 through 32. Instead, we hold to the truth in love, becoming more and more in every way like Christ, who is the head of his body, the church. Under his direction, the whole body is fitted together perfectly. As each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts grow, so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love. With the Lord's authority, let me say this. Live no longer as the ungodly do, for they are hopelessly confused. Their closed minds are full of darkness. They are far away from the life of God, because they have shut their minds and hardened their hearts against him. They don't care anymore about right and wrong, and they have given themselves over to immoral ways. Their lives are filled with all kinds of impurity and greed. But that isn't what you were taught when you learned about Christ. Since you have heard all about him and have learned the truth that is in Jesus, throw off your old evil nature, your former way of life, which is rotten through and through, full of lust and deception. Instead, there must be a spiritual renewal of your thoughts and attitudes. You must display a new nature, because you are a new person, created in God's likeness, righteous, holy, and true. So put away all falsehood, and tell your neighbor the truth, because we belong to each other. And don't sin by letting anger gain control over you. Don't let the sun go down while you are still angry. For anger gives a mighty foothold to the devil. If you are a thief, stop stealing. Begin using your hands for honest work. And then give generously to others in need. Don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. And do not bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way forgiving one another just as God through Christ has forgiven you. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Our current worship series is focused on new life, the new life that we receive through Christ. 2 weeks ago, Keith spoke about baptism and the new life gained through the sacrament of baptism and the joys of joining the church. Last week, we read from Isaiah, where God speaks to the Israelites in exile about the new way forward he has created for his people. Today, we are hearing from Paul in the book of Ephesians as he speaks to the church of Ephesus. Throughout the book of Ephesians, Paul is writing to strengthen believers in the church and draw them together as members of the body of Christ. Paul speaks to the new nature we receive and the new person we become because of Christ's sacrifice. Brennan Manning, in his book, The Furious Longing of God, describes the new life that Paul is speaking of by saying, "The gospel is absurd and the life of Christ is meaningless unless we believe that he lived, died, and rose again with but one purpose in mind, to make brand new creation. That is what we are because of Jesus' sacrifice, a brand new creation. Through Jesus' death on the cross, his great sacrifice, we are given a clean slate, a new beginning, freedom from the sins of our past and the threat of death in our future. We are no longer the people we were before knowing Christ. The new life that we receive in Christ includes each of us being given a fresh start and a new relationship with God. Before Christ, there was a gap between us and God. We were divided by sin and death. We see that divide played out over and over again in our Old Testament scripture, from Genesis through Malachi. We see the Israelites struggling, making the same mistakes, measuring and judging one another, turning their backs on God, and worshiping idols whenever times are tough. God chose people like Moses, Joshua, the prophets and the judges, to guide his people, and the Israelites relied on the high priest to make sacrifices on their behalf in order to atone for sins. But everything changed when God came to earth as Jesus, a man who suffered and died on the cross. Through his sacrifice, that gap between us and God was forever bridged. We no longer rely on the high priest to go before God and make sacrifices on our behalf in order to receive forgiveness. We can now go before God without fear, for we know that our sin has been forgiven. We no longer need someone to speak to God for us. Through our new life, we have received such a great gift in the Holy Spirit, and we now have Christ, we have the Holy Spirit living within us, God guiding us from the inside. Our new life in Christ brings us into a personal relationship with God. And our new life brings new and wonderful relationships with others as well. Today is Father's Day, a day built on people in relationship with one another, gathering together to celebrate Dad and all he has done for our family. We celebrate Dads for bringing laughter and joy, silliness and adventure, and lots of love to our families. I'm looking forward to spending time with my dad and family today, and I'm sure many others are preparing for cookouts and camping trips and other family fun. This is a day full of joy for many families. However, for many other families, Father's Day can be a day of great pain. Some may want to skip over Father's Day because of the father they never knew, the dad that was absent, or the dad they may have wished was absent because when he was there, he was abusive. For many, Father's Day can be painful as they remember and mourn the dad that's no longer here, their absence always felt. For others, there is pain and grief for fathers who don't wish to celebrate today because of disconnected relationships with children lost to this world, or children whose lives were taken from this world far too soon. We live in a broken world that can bring pain to even the happiest of days. But there is hope and joy awaiting each of us 68 says, God is Father to the fatherless, defender of the helpless. The Lord has adopted us as his own children. Romans 8:15 through 16 says, you should behave like God's very own children, adopted into his family, calling him Father, dear Father, for his Holy Spirit speaks to us deep in our hearts and tells us that we are God's children. Along with a new relationship with our Father God, we also receive a new family in Christ. That is what the body of Christ is, the church, a family of believers united and bound to one another through the love and sacrifice of Christ. We are made in the image of God our Father, and we are made to be a reflection of Him. Therefore, we also are called to be fathers to the fatherless in our family and church. We are called to love and serve those around us with the guidance and support of the Holy Spirit. There is even greater joy in knowing that the new life offered to each of us is not limited to this world that we now reside. Not only do we receive new life here in this broken world, but we also receive an eternal new life, free from pain, beyond what we see and know here. An eternal new life filled with family long before us and the family we have in Christ. In Paul's letter to the Ephesians, he tells of the wonderful gift of new life that we each receive. But he doesn't stop there. In verse 22, Paul writes, throw off your old nature and your former way of life. Now, normally, I am not the person to tell anyone to throw something old out and replace it with something new. One of my habits seems to be collecting old things that possibly could be used again. My husband will tell you that I am the first person to get up at Christmas and birthday parties to collect the bows and the bags and even tissue paper that I can smooth out and fold again. Not to name any names, but I went to a baby shower yesterday and saw them throwing away tissue paper and my eye twitched just a little. I still have, bags and bags at home. I have clothes that haven't been worn in years because they may fit again one day. And boxes of half-used art supplies. I have new items as well, but you never know when you may need that something and not have it. I think it's good to conserve items and use all that you can of something old before throwing it out and getting something new. That works well when it comes to saving and reducing waste. But as we listen to Paul, we learn that it doesn't work so well for our faith in Christ. Sometimes we have that same attitude of saving our old life, life before Christ, like we do with material items in our homes. Keeping the old life in the back of our minds, because you never know when you're going to need it. You may find yourself saying, well, I don't really know what this new life in Christ is going to be. What if it doesn't work for me like my former life did? There are some parts of my old life that I really enjoy. Keep those parts and still have a new life, or my new life is tighter and a little restrictive. I think I liked it better with my old life. That may have been faded and covered with holes, but it was comfortable. New life doesn't mean easy life. This new life came at enormous cost to God. It will also involve a great cost for us. Romans 8:17 says, and since we are God's children, we will share his treasures, for everything God gives to his Son, Christ, is ours too. But if we share his glory, we must also share his suffering. Grace is God's freely offered gift to us. But in order to truly embrace and live this blessing of new life in Christ, we must sacrifice as well, giving up that old, comfortable life we lived before. Our new life as children of God must look different than our life before. Otherwise, what is the point? have to change our ways in order to accept the forgiveness God offers us. But we should want to. Otherwise, the life we are living really isn't new after all. The words we use, the stories we tell, our actions, and our treatment of others should all be new. A sacrifice we each make in response to the gift that God has given us. If our life before Christ looks identical to life after knowing Christ, we aren't living into all the wonderful possibilities given to us by God. Instead, we are hoarding what is old, keeping that life hidden away in case we need a plan B, thus putting our faith in ourselves and our own plans. When our faith, trust, and full dependence is put in God, we are changed people, and our lives will be a sign to the world that we are a new creation made by God. This new life will still have pain, death, and brokenness, but we must remember that this isn't our home. Through Christ's sacrifice and the bridge that now connects us to God, we have a heavenly Father and a heavenly home, filled with our family in Christ, awaiting us after we leave this broken world. A new life means we are residents of a new home. Let us embrace our new life in Christ today and reap all the benefits that this life of God has to offer. Amen.
Thank you.
and more about our fathers. Let's pray. For fathers everywhere who have given us life and love, that we may show them respect and love. Dear Lord,
hear our prayers.
For fathers who have lost a child through death, that their faith may give them hope, and their family and friends support and console them. Dear Lord,
hear our prayers.
For men, though without children of their own, acted like a father and nurtured and cared for us. Dear Lord,
hear our prayers.
For stepfathers who have assumed that role with love and joy, who have loved the children of another as their own, and created a new family. Dear Lord, for adopted fathers who have claimed the orphan and loved the once unwanted as a precious gift of God. Dear Lord, for fathers who have been unable to be a source of strength, who have not responded to the needs of their children, and have not sustained their families, we seek mercy and strength. Dear Lord, for fathers who struggle with temptation, violence, or addiction, for those who do harm, and for those whom they have harmed, we pray for mercy and for healing. Dear Lord, for new fathers full of hope, for long-time fathers full of wisdom, for fathers yet to be, and fathers soon to be, dear Lord, for those that have shaped our lives without claim of family or kinship, for those who have taught us, guided us, shaped us, and molded us into servants of Christ our Lord. Dear Lord, God our Father, in your wisdom and love, you made all things. Bless these men that they may be strengthened as Christian fathers. Let the example of their faith and love shine forth. Grant that we, their sons and daughters, may honor them always with a spirit of profound respect. Grant this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Dear Lord. Amen. Well, we have a special prayer time today. I am going to invite Marion Myers to come forward. Marion has a mission trip leaving for Africa this week. This will be
10th year to Africa, 9th year to City of Hope. She's going to the school, the City of Hope, and this will be her 10th time there. And we are so thankful that you are taking a group there. I think so 21 people will be traveling there. And so today we are going to pray over there and pray over her trip and pray for her and all those that are going.
I did. You know, I always do say something. It was 29 years ago, this spring, that the Lord spoke to my heart about becoming a missionary. I've been raised in a mission family all my life, and so it was a natural thing for me, but it has been a really meaningful experience. Yeah, it's God, called God, special to missionary work, and I joined with a young man from Kenya who was raised in a remote village. And he said, as a little boy, he would see a big bird flying. He didn't know anything about airplanes, but he said, someday, I'm going to fly. And through God's graciousness, he was able to come to this country, and he came into my life, and I met him, and I helped him form a ministry called Teamwork Ministry. But 10 years ago, because of the AIDS pandemic, and all the children who had been left fatherless, and many widows there. But we have started the City of Hope, and this is our 10th anniversary, and we are so thrilled at all that the Lord has just done miraculous things. I call it a real miracle, because in the beginning, we had just a plot of ground. And the first year I went, I took a shovel and took dirt out of that ground. And now, 10 years later, we have, within the mile-long chain link fence that you
raised $14,000 to build. We have a mission house, a children's home with 100 orphans, a school with 400 students every day. Just a wonderful, wonderful ministry there in the City of Hope. And in a place where there has never been a medical facility, we have a clinic that has a doctor and two nurses on call 7 days a week, all day long and all night. Because as our young doctor says, babies don't know the difference between night and day. So I'm going back to the City of Hope to see, especially this time, our secondary school. We've only had a school going through the seventh grade, and now we've been able, through just the generosity of some people, we've been able to finish our secondary school, and now we'll take our children through the 12th grade. But also, I have 36 grandchildren, I call them, at Mountain Mission School in Rundy, Virginia, who've been given complete scholarships through high school. And this week I was with them and I threw out questions to them and they understood my questions and they answered in English. And so it's just a wonderful thing what we are able to do when everybody, like our congregation here and other congregations, join together to make a difference in the lives of those who have suffered pain, persecution, and hopelessness, and now their lives are being transformed. I'm really proud of the team that's going this year because 14 from my son's church in Connecticut are joining with me. I've tried to take all members of my family to the City of Hope because we consider it a real family mission. People say to me, aren't you afraid to go over there and fly in a little missionary plane and land in a cornfield on the strip and then get in an old Land Rover and go over dirt rock roads? And those of you who've been to Africa know what those roads are like. And I said, no, you know, I think that the Lord can use you until he carries you home. It really doesn't matter where you are when he decides to do that. But I come to you today representing you, my church. I want to thank you for what you have done in the past. The first thing that you helped us do was to put desks in the school where the children sit in the middle school where the children were sitting on dirt floors. And you know Chester Lane made all those little desks and you all bought them for $25 a piece and we were able to get 200 desks and we're still using those desks. Then you helped to build a chain link fence. And I think of all these paper chains we're seeing around the church. You remember then, for every foot of fence that you bought, we put something in the chain and get paper chains all around this church. So you made it possible for us to have a fence to close in our City of Hope and to make the children secure there. Then you helped us in our water problem. And water is a big problem all over the world. And so we needed fresh water and you helped us with water, with money to drill a well. And on, you have supported me in every way. I am so grateful because lives are being transformed with children who would have no hope and women who would have no medical facilities. And all the things that we're able to continually do because God moves on your hearts and you give so willingly in every way to support the ministry. But I go out under your cover because you are the body of Christ and I'm a part of that. So I ask for your prayers as we travel. I know we are under God's protection and it's going to be a thrilling, thrilling time to see all that God is doing. Our way because of what people here are willing to do. So thank you for your support and your love and your prayer.